Good morning, everybody, and happy Sunday. It is so good to see all of you here today. How many of you are excited to be in church this morning? Let's see a show of hands. I love that. When I see that, it makes me excited. Thank you so much for coming out and being a part of our celebration today. As you can see, we are right in the middle of a series right now called Relational Vampires. And by vampires, I mean those people who just seem to suck the life out of you. Now, before we even start with this, here's what I want you to do. Before we even start, let me ask you a question. How many of you have someone in your life who's just really, really good to you? I mean, they encourage you, they support you, they make your life better. If you're sitting next to that person right now, I want you to turn to them. Place your hand upon your heart and say, "You complete me." And now turn to the person on the other side of you and say, "And you deplete me." Well, we're going to be talking today about those people who deplete you in life, who take the joy and the energy out of your life. Now, isn't it amazing that there are certain people who can just kind of flip your mood so quickly? I mean, you could be having a good day. You're going through your day. I mean, it's a good day. The sun is shining. The flowers are blooming. And you're feeling good. And then this person comes along. And they know exactly what to do to push your buttons. And they can flip your attitude in like 1.2 seconds. You know, they can turn you from being happy to being angry. Well, we're going to talk today about how to disarm that kind of person. How do you defend yourself from that? How do you deal with your own temper and not lose it when you have to deal with that kind of person? Well, the good news is the Bible gives us some very, very practical advice on that. We're going to be spending our time this morning in the book of Proverbs, which is the Bible's book of wisdom. And it's got some wise, wise advice for you and for me on how to not let people push our buttons and make us lose our temper. So here goes. Here's some advice from the Bible. First of all, before you lose it, calculate the cost. If you're taking notes on your outline right now, write that down. Calculate the cost. Look, you allow yourself to fly off the handle, and instead of doing that, you just need to stop, take a step back, take a deep breath, and think it through. You're less likely to get angry if you realize there's always going to be a price tag. Think of that. Whenever you get angry, whenever you lose your temper, there's always going to be a price tag, and you're going to have to pay that price. The Bible's very, very specific about uncontrolled anger. Let me show you some verses out of Proverbs. We're going to analyze this together. First of all, Proverbs 29:22, an angry person causes trouble. That's the first thing. Circle trouble if you want to analyze this with me. And a person with a quick temper sins a lot. You can circle sins a lot. You're going to get into more trouble, and you're going to sin more if you lose your temper. Proverbs 15:18, hot tempers cause arguments, circle arguments. Proverbs 14:29, anger causes mistakes, circle mistakes, you're going to make more mistakes. Proverbs 14:27, people with hot tempers do foolish things. You could circle do foolish things. So, okay, let me break this down for you. Let's analyze it together. So, what the Bible is saying is, if I lose my temper, I'm going to get myself in trouble. I'm going to sin, I'm going to get into an argument, I'm going to make mistakes, and I'm going to do some foolish things. So, do I want to lose my temper just because you're pushing my buttons? Absolutely not. Listen, I don't want to give you that kind of power over me. I don't want to give you that kind of power over me. Remember this. When you lose your temper, you always lose. When you lose your temper, you always lose. So the next time someone is pushing your buttons, just stop, take a deep breath, and walk away. And if you can't walk away, here's what you do. Look past their words and see their wounds. Number two, look past their words and see their wounds. You see, you don't want to respond just to what they're saying. You want to try to figure out why they're saying what they're saying. And I've told you this before, hurt people hurt people. Wounded people wound people. When somebody is lashing out at you, it means that they've been hurt and they're still hurting. Unkind people are simply people who have never known kindness in their own life. Unloving people are people who feel themselves unloved. And when somebody's being rude, when they're sarcastic, when they're mean-spirited, when they're attacking you, they are shouting out for the entire world to hear through their behavior, I need attention. That bad behavior, that's them saying, I need attention. I am not feeling loved. I am not feeling secure. Because listen to me, secure people don't do that. They don't act that way. They're not rude. They're not judgmental. They're not in your face. When somebody's mean, they're telegraphing as loud as possible, I am in pain. And unfortunately, what they need is not what they deserve. What they need is love and kindness. What they need is patience. The Bible tells us a wise man is patient, and it is to his credit when he overlooks an offense. So if you're wise, you look past the words. You look behind the words. You're patient, and you overlook a few things. Then the third thing you need to do is a really big one. Think before reacting. Number three, think before reacting. Thomas Jefferson said, when you're angry, count to 10. If you're really angry, count to 100. He's right. Anger control is largely a matter of mouth control. Don't be impulsive. Don't think before you speak. Put your mind in gear before you put your mouth in gear. The Bible tells us sensible people always think before they act. And a fool gives vent to his full anger, but a wise person quietly holds it back. So what do I do when I'm holding it back that way? I'm trying to understand that other person who's ticking me off. I'm trying to understand what's going on inside of them. If you really want to understand what's going on, you look past the behavior and you look at the root cause. And let me give you a little hint right here. Anger is always caused by three things. One of three things. It's not that difficult. Anger is always caused by just one of three things. The first cause of anger is hurt. When you get hurt, you get angry. If I'm pounding a nail in with a hammer and I pound my thumb, I don't say, praise the Lord, right? I'm angry if that happens. I'm angry at my thumb. I'm angry at the hammer. I'm angry at life at that point. And why is that? Because hurt produces anger. So when you're wounded, either physically or psychologically, you're going to be angry. You're going to be an angry person. The second cause of anger is frustration. When you get frustrated, you naturally get angry. For example, when you're forced to wait, you get annoyed. You know, that's why the motor vehicle department is like the unhappiest place on earth. When you get stuck in traffic, you pound the steering wheel. Why? It's not the steering wheel that's making you late, but you pound the steering wheel because that's what happens to be there. And when somebody's being angry with you, when somebody's being nasty to you, when they're not treating you right, it may have nothing at all to do with you. It may mean that you're just in their vicinity. You just happen to be the one who's there, and so they're letting it fly. You know, they're just throwing out anger in every direction, and you just happen to be the one there to catch it. And then the third cause of fear, or the third cause of anger is fear. Hurt, frustration, and the third cause is fear. When we feel threatened, we're gonna fight back. You take an animal and you put them in a corner, they're gonna fight back. You take a person and make them feel cornered, and they're gonna fight back. A lot of people are just plain afraid. Afraid they're gonna lose their status at work. Afraid they're gonna lose something that makes them feel comfortable. Afraid they're gonna lose face in front of other people. They're afraid they're gonna lose their power, their position, their possessions, their prestige, their privileges. You see, I just want you to be smart when it comes to relationships. Think before you speak. Reflect before you react. You ask yourself, where's this all coming from? What's the root cause of all this? You see, it's a lot easier to be patient with someone if you realize that They're just really a person who's afraid, or they're emotionally wounded, or they're frustrated at their own situation. I want you to be smart. That's how you disarm button pushers. But one more thing. I want you to have the power in the relationship. I want you to have the power. And so, ask God for help. Number four, ask God for help. The Bible says, Lord, help me control my tongue. Help me be careful what I say. That might be a good verse for some of us to memorize. You know, the next time you're about to lose it, just say that in your mind. Lord, help me. Lord, help me. Think of it this way. Suppose I was up here right now, I'm holding a tube of toothpaste in my hand, and I say to you, if I squeeze this tube of toothpaste, what's going to come out of it? You'd be like, is this a trick question, right? You'd be like, toothpaste, right? If you squeeze a tube of toothpaste is what's going to come out. Well, in the exact same way, when life starts to squeeze you, when life starts to squeeze your heart, when you feel like the pressure is on you, do you know what's going to come out? Whatever's inside. So if I'm always losing it, if I'm always getting angry and lashing out at people, I can't blame anybody else around me. I can't blame the circumstances. It's what's coming out of me. Pressure just reveals what's inside of me. Let me tell you something about anger. The heart of the problem is a problem of the heart. Right? Do I have to say that again? The heart of the problem is a problem of the heart. When you're under pressure and you start to take it out on other people around you, you want to say, holy cow, where's all that coming from? You know where it's coming from. It's coming from inside of you. That's what's in your heart. The key is to change what's in your heart. Let me say it again. The key is to change what is in your heart. You know, if you've got a well in your yard, and that well is giving you bad water, fixing the pump isn't going to change the problem. It's going to fix the problem. You're still going to be pumping out dirty water. That's the problem with a lot of self-help books. They tell you how to fix the pump, but they don't tell you how to fix the water in the well. Until you fix it, things aren't going to change. So what do? How do you really make things different? You let God into your life. I mean in a real way. You let God's Spirit into your life. And you ask God to fill you with His Spirit. That's changing the water in the well. That's getting to the heart of the problem. You know, I've found that when I get all full of myself, when I'm all full of Jeff, almost anything gets to me. Anything annoys me. Anything, everything irritates me and upsets me. But if I'm filled with God's Spirit, to the extent that I'm filled with God's Spirit, it's like almost nothing can upset me because I've got a power inside of me. I've got a power that is greater than my own human power. I've got a power that's greater than any power in this world. So how do you get filled with God's Spirit? Well, don't make it too complicated. It just means you're going to be looking to God for your strength and not yourself. Maybe just say a simple little prayer, two words, help me. Help me. Those three things that cause anger, hurt, frustration, and fear, Jesus can heal those three things. Jesus can heal your hurt with His love. Jesus can replace your frustration with His peace. And Jesus can replace your insecurity with His power. I mean, did you ever see a baby in its mother's arms? If a mother picks up her crying baby and holds that baby close, it feels warm and safe and secure. And that baby stops crying, stops being angry. Today's the day you let your Father, today's the day you let your Heavenly Father hold you close. Because when you feel accepted and secure. When you feel totally loved, your anger is going to begin to disappear. So let's go to our Father now. Let's bow our heads and come before Him. And why don't you let me lead you? Father, it's sad but true. We often get angry the most with the people we love the most, the people who are closest to us, because we forget that You're the source of all that we really need, not them. Father, help us to remember that when we expect anybody else to meet needs that only You can meet, we're going to be disappointed. We're going to be let down. We're going to be angry. Father, I'm certain that there are people listening to me right now who are struggling with anger issues. They're angry because they're hurt, or because of frustration, or because of insecurity. And You, Father, are the answer to all three of those things. Help them experience hope and healing today. Fill them with Your Spirit today. And now you pray. Dear God, just say this in your mind. Just say, Dear God, I admit that I have a problem with anger, and I let other people push my buttons, and I get even, and I retaliate, and I fight back, and I don't think before I speak. So I'm asking for Your help. Help me reflect before reacting. Help me learn to release my anger appropriately. Father, I open myself to You completely. Come into my life. Save me. Change me. Make changes inside of me that can happen in no other way. Make the well waters deep inside my heart run clean and pure once again. I ask it all in the name of Jesus. Amen. And now we continue our prayers, praying as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.